Hello, everybody. This is Brother Luke, Sin City Preacher. Welcome to this Sunday's program for the Church of the Eternally Secure. In fact, it's not only our Sunday program, but this is, of course, a special Sunday, being what the world calls Easter Sunday, but I think most of us would call it the Resurrection Sunday, Resurrection Day. I'm sure that will be part of our conversation today, discussing this resurrection. But if you're here with us for the first time, welcome. I hope you enjoy your time with us today. I hope it's beneficial, and maybe you'll want to join us every Sunday. And we also have a Wednesday night Bible study that starts at 9:30 p.m. Eastern time. I invite you to join us for that also. Before we get started with our program, though, well, first let me see, address the chat room. I'm not sure how many people are in there yet. Celine and Jared, I see, are there. Okay, so if you're in the chat room, welcome back, and thank you for being there. Please be diligent at controlling any trolls who might show up today. Hopefully we won't have that problem. Also, make sure that if you're a moderator in the chat room, if you see someone new, please make an effort to welcome them. And all right, let's get started with the program. First, Brother Matthias is here with me now. So some people might not know who you are or what Talk and Doctrine does. So take just a minute to tell them about that, please.
All right. Well, happy Resurrection Day, everybody. It's awesome to have another year to glorify the resurrection of Jesus. And if you haven't checked out Talk and Doctrine, we've got a bunch of different things we do over there between Bible studies and panel discussions. The other night we had a conversation between three of us, two atheists. It was actually very cordial and a good discussion. Two of which actually lost their religion. So it was fun learning about the things that cause people to stop believing and really see if they had a real or superficial faith from the beginning. But we just have conversations with people, whether you agree with us on doctrine or disagree, we want to talk to you. So hit us up, join us for the conversation, and we'll see you in the chat room.
Amen. I got a comment from someone on last Sunday's program asking to be able to join our panel. And I tried to explain to them in the comment that we love for them to participate by viewing, also participating in the chat rooms. But the panel is limited, and we don't have it open for everybody to join in the panel. However, for those people who want to participate in any panel discussions, I invite you to use Talk and Doctrine in that way. Brother Matthias is very open and welcoming to anybody who wants to join a panel discussion. And talk about pretty much any subject that you're interested in. So I believe he's filling a need to give that opportunity to everybody. All right. If you're wondering about Sister Renee, she contacted me earlier today and said that she was invited to a family dinner that conflicts with the time today because it's Easter Sunday. A lot of people use this occasion for like a Thanksgiving or Christmas, you know, family get-togethers. So that's where she will be today. We are expecting Brother Daniel to join us since he hasn't told us otherwise. I imagine he'll be here anytime. But let me tell you about my channel just for a moment in case you're new. My channel is Sin City Preacher. I've had my channel on YouTube for about 10 years now. Initially, I focused exclusively on the gospel. I wanted to tell people the good news about who Jesus is and how we receive salvation. But after a while, people asked me so many theological questions that were not related to those two things, the identity of Jesus and the means of salvation. And I tried to resist answering all those questions because I didn't want to get sidetracked from what is the most important thing. But once I gave in and started answering the questions and making videos on it and forming playlists, my channel kind of has evolved so that even though evangelism, the gospel, the identity of Jesus, this remains the most important focal point of my channel. My channel also serves now, I think, as a resource. If you have an interest in any theological subject, you will probably find that information on my many playlists. So I invite you to peruse all my playlists, and if you find a playlist of interest to you, I hope you will take the time to carefully look at it and consider it. All right. Okay, the next thing we want to do is make any announcements, and I guess I've made a decision that there's three things I'm going to continue announcing until I'm satisfied that we've accomplished these things. And the first is I want to encourage and promote the use of some clever one-liners that some of us have either invented. Maybe some of these are inspired. But when I hear one of these clever one-liners that in a very succinctly express a very powerful biblical point, I want to encourage that we adopt these and repeat them over and over again. As a congregation, let's keep repeating them and make them become very, very well known. And some of them that we've already added, we started a list, and I'll read a few of them very quickly here just so you know what I'm talking about. And if you have something that fits the bill here, send it to me. I'll add it to our list. The first on the list is from Brother Ronnie Hood Minister. Years ago, he told me this, and I thought it was exactly what we need. And he coined the phrase, we have a license to rest. One that I've invented or developed or is the gift and the guarantee. Salvation is about the gift and the guarantee. Another one that I've used is works never work. In other words, working for salvation did not work in the times past. It doesn't work in this church age, and it will not work in the future. Works never work. And then grace means no works. In other words, the actual definition of grace is grace means no works. Something we heard from Sister Renee's channel recently is you don't clean a fish before you catch it. Of course, we're going to go through these one night. The whole point of all these things is I want to have a group discussion one night where we go and actually discuss the deep meaning of all these sayings. The one I heard many years ago from Sister Lisa Harang, she said the gospel is believe, not behave. I've been trying to get people to adopt the terminology. I am a Christian, not a Christian. I'm a Christian. And what we have here is Christianity, not Christianity, because that tells us that what we have is really the focal point is Jesus Christ. Religion says do, do, do. Jesus says done. Well, I've got many more on the list, and we'll be going over them all very thoroughly in the future. But I wanted to give you an idea of the kind of one-liners I'm looking for, and I'm going to ask you to send them to me in the chat room or just comments on the videos, and I'll add them to this list. And then we'll do a program where we go into detail talking about the deep meaning behind each of these sayings.
Hey, Brother Luke, I've got the one that I've shared in here before, God will never accept your failed attempts at keeping the law.
Yes, I do have that on my list. It's down near the bottom. It's one of the most recent I've added to it. And so thank you for telling me again, but it's on my list.
And I put a couple in the chat room last week, so I wouldn't forget them later.
Yeah, let me see. I think there's the most recent ones we've added are Jonathan Bowers sent us a couple that I'll have added to the list. Let me see. God will never accept your failed attempts at keeping the law. People think it's not fair for me to have something for free that they are working so hard to get. Everyone has faith, but not everyone has faith that counts. And we got more. The list is growing. So when we do have our group discussion going through these, it'll be there'll be a lot to talk about. The other announcements I want to make is that we do have one person that has contacted me, say, put me on the list. I want to come to Las Vegas and have a get together. What do you call it when you group people get together? I forgot that. But Renee, Jason Cripps, Brother Michael, they've all said they'd like to join us in Las Vegas so we can all get together one time sometime this year. And also fed by his rays, BJO Miller said, put my name on the list. I want to come to Las Vegas. So if you want to be put on this list so that we can coordinate this and establish a time, a date that will work for everybody, contact me, let me know if you're interested in joining us so that we can actually meet in person one time. And then, of course, the other announcement is I'm going to do a special program about miracles that we've experienced. If you want to be on that program, if you have a miracle that you'd like to share with us in a group discussion, then please let me know. I have Stacy Cook has contacted me, Sister Flora is on the list, and Renee, and then myself. So if others have miracles that you'd like to share on that program, let me know. I'll add to the list, and we'll set up a time and to do that. All right, those are the only announcements I have to make. Matthias or Daniel, do you have any announcements?
No announcements.
No, other than I would like to be put on that list to meet you guys in person.
Right, yeah. It's later this year. Hopefully we can make it.
All right. I'll add you, Daniel. Matthias, did you say you will join us sometime if it's later this year?
Yeah. If money issues work out, then of course.
Okay. I'll put you both on the list then. Okay. That'll be it for the announcements. The next part of our program are the needs of prayer for the congregation. And I did not receive any prayer requests this week. I'm sure that there are prayer needs. So Daniel and Matthias, if you're aware of any prayer needs in the congregation, let me know.
Just pray for my friend Pam and also my other friend Connie that goes to church with us. She's been having a lot of issues. She's been in the hospital. So continue praying for her, Connie and Pam.
Matthias, any prayer needs?
I got many prayer needs, but too many to list. But no, thank you.
All right. Okay, then, let's do that now. Let's take 30 seconds. We'll be silent for 30 seconds, and everybody in the congregation, pray for these needs. And if you have any other needs, then go ahead and include those. Of course, Renee's been asking, since she's not here, I'll speak for her. She's been asking for a lot of people's healings and needs to be met, particularly one, Manly Moses is one that she's put at the front of her list. So I will mention that since she's not here to do it. All right, let's take 30 seconds of silence, and everybody please pray in your own way now. right. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Now, the next part of the program is our praise and worship music. So I'll turn this over to Brother Daniel now.
All right. Since today is Easter, I wanted to sing a few of those songs. Maybe haven't done it in a while, but this one's called Up From the Grave He Arose. Jesus, my Savior, waiting the coming day, Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave he arose, with a mighty triumph over his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, he arose, hallelujah, Christ arose. Vainly they watch his bed, Jesus, my Savior. Vainly they seal the dead, Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave he arose, with a mighty triumph for his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, he arose, hallelujah, Christ arose. Death cannot keep his prey, Jesus, my Savior. He tore the bars away, Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave he rose, with a mighty triumph over his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, he arose, hallelujah, Christ arose. All right, and then because he lives. God sent his son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future. Life is worth living, just because he lives. Forgiven. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy he gives.
because he lives, because he lives, I can face tomorrow, because he lives, all fear is gone, because I know he holds the future, and life is worth living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross that river, I'll fight life's fight. Then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the light's glory, and I'll know he reigns. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone, because I know he holds the future, and life is worth living just because he lives, and life is worth living just because he lives.
I don't have to wait till I see those lights. I already know he lives.
And amen.
I know he reigns, but I forgot to change the lyrics in my head while I was singing it. So,
all right. Thank you, brother. That was beautiful. Wow. Let's take a minute before we get started just to acknowledge the chat here. Cupcake Puppy, she wants me to add her list to the Las Vegas. So I'll put her down there too. And let me see, we've got a lot of hellos from everybody here to us. Anna and Tim Girl, after we'd started the prayers, I noticed that Tim Girl asked if we could pray for her and her family. They're going through some struggle now. So please, everybody, pray for Tim Girl's needs. Alex is here with us too, and Anna. Olive and Hill, nice to see you again here. Yeah, I know you needed prayers too. I hope things are going better for you. And Karen says she's always praying for all of us. And of course, everybody, just keep on praying for Brother Daniel. We know that his health is still not what it needs to be. And okay, Resurrection Day. I guess I've got some questions. I'm interested in discussing this with everybody. But first, let me just talk about, I think, a couple of great resources. If you want to know more about this resurrection, I have a playlist titled The Resurrection. Of course, you know I'm going to tell this. I'm going to always send you to one of my playlists. That's because I put a lot of time and effort into producing it, and I think that it's worthwhile and could be very helpful to you. But the resource that we used for that study on the resurrection was a very simple little book by Josh McDowell, More Than a Carpenter. Oh, by the way, let me show you my shirt today. Brother Matthias has a great Jesus shirt on today, too. Jesus, one way to heaven, it says. First, and Daniel, I don't know if you got a Jesus shirt on, but Matthias and I have both wore ours. Okay, this little book here. It's a short version of his longer book called Evidence That Demands a Verdict. That book, Volume 1 and Volume 2, are very, very large and exhaustive stark books on apologetics, proving the Bible's true and Christianity's true. So if you really want to go into great study on this, look at Josh McDowell's books, Evidence That Demands a Verdict, and his second one is titled More Evidence That Demands a Verdict. But this one is only a paperback, and I've given out hundreds of these over the years. I wasn't giving them out as freely as a Bible tract, but I always would have many on me so that if someone struck a conversation and I felt that this could be helpful to them, I had some available to give them. It's only 128 pages. But the study that I did on the teaching of the resurrection that I did with a few other people, watched that. But what we did is we read this book together and discussed it. And it's really, really very, very compelling. Another resource that I think that you will enjoy and be very helpful. I don't recommend that many movies from Hollywood that are, you know, about the Bible, but there's one that came out a couple of years ago called Risen. Simply that one word, Risen. If you haven't seen it, I urge you to find it and see it. You can probably find it free on Netflix or somewhere now. And it not only gives you a correct account that does not contradict anything in the Bible, but there's extra biblical resources they've used to fill in the blanks of some of the things that we believe are probably correct also. And it's very, very good. So that's what I would recommend. Go to my playlist and watch the Resurrection playlist. Read this book, More Than a Carpenter. That's what the playlist is based on. And see the movie Risen. Before we go into our own discussion on it, Matthias and Daniel, do you have any resources or anything that you would recommend on that subject?
The movie Risen I've seen, and that's great, but I would recommend that as well. But for the resurrection, no, I would say Risen's one of the best things out there. Especially, I'm surprised, especially because it came pretty much through Hollywood. So I was actually pleased with that when I watched it. I actually paid $2.99 to watch it on YouTube with my family. So that's how I got it.
Awesome. Yeah, most of the time, if we watch anything made from Hollywood about the Bible, those of us who study the Bible a lot, we find little errors here and there. But I don't recall any issues in that movie at all. If we wanted to really scrutinize, maybe we could find some fault, but I don't remember any. Daniel, anything you want to recommend to everybody about the resurrection? Any other resources? All right, then. Well, let me start off by just asking this question. What is the significance of the resurrection to a Christian? And also to the world as a whole. Let me start off with asking Daniel that question. You guys still with me?
Yeah. I don't know what's... I showed him a trick on how he could get to the mouse quicker. I don't know. You might have... I don't know.
Well, you want to go first while he's trying to figure that out?
Yeah. So what's the significance of the resurrection
to the believer? To the church, to the believers, and then also to the world as a whole.
Well, the easy, simple answer to the church and believers, if Christ is not risen, then we're still dead in our sins. The power that he exemplified to defeat death in the grave is, I'm using the biblical term, hope. It's our earnest expectation of our own rising when he returns. And for the world, Oh man, that there's no excuse. That everybody, before they get saved, they're scared of dying. They don't know what's on the other end. But they've heard a story about a man. They wonder if he's a God man, but they've heard the story about a man who defeated what they're so scared of, and yet they still don't humble themselves and go to him. So I would say his resurrection proves they have no excuse. And for us, the resurrection, while the death is where the shedding of blood is where the forgiveness of sins is, the resurrection is the power that we're standing in.
All right. Thank you. Brother Daniel, can you unmute and tell us?
Here, I'll walk in there too. Make sure everything's all right.
Okay. Well, while they're waiting, I'll go ahead and talk about the resurrection for answer the question next. Do you remember, if you've read the Bible, you know that after Jesus was arrested, all of the apostles fled. Of course, most people believe that John, the apostle John, followed them and stayed there, at least not probably in the room where the trial was held against Jesus by the Sanhedrin, but he was close by. He did not desert him as the others did. And then Peter, he was there for a while until he denied him three times, and then he finally left completely. But all the other apostles, they were hiding. So the question is, why were they all hiding? We should understand that this was a time, probably it was logical for them to assume and believe that they were also on the list to be arrested and tried because they were followers of Jesus. So I think the Bible tells us, and also history tells us, that they were afraid for their lives. And when you watch that movie, The Risen, you get a very good demonstration of what was going on at that time. But one of the great arguments for in apologetics, this is why I asked the question in two ways. To the world as a whole, why should I believe in Christianity? Isn't it just a bunch of you know fables and fictional stories and moral lessons? And, that's all there is to it. You don't really take it seriously, take it literally, do you? That's the way the world sees the Bible and Christianity. But of all of the arguments that we have under the umbrella of what many people would call apologetics. Apologetics is our attempt to defend our faith and defend the Bible. Of all of the things under apologetics, the resurrection of Jesus Christ is at the top of the list in power. That's why this entire book is entirely about proving the Bible is true and Jesus is who he claimed to be by proving that the resurrection really happened. So what happened during that three-day period where the apostles are hiding out afraid for their lives? Then suddenly they change from being cowards, thinking that they're going to be next to be arrested and killed, to being the absolutely brave, courageous witnesses, preachers, proclaiming he is risen. That really was the original gospel message. Hey, he's alive. And then, of course, when you killed him, it served the purpose of paying for all of our sins. But guess what? He's risen. That was the message, and that remains the message to today. But because he was risen and because he appeared to Acts, it says that the gospel is that Paul taught. He says, if you continue believing in this gospel, that is that he died for our sins, he was buried, and he was raised from the dead on the third day, according to the scriptures. I've just paraphrased it, but and then it goes on to say in the following verses, and it was witnessed by Paul, by all the apostles, by Jesus' brother James, and then all, actually even at 400 people or 500 people at the same time, Jesus appeared to this large group of people. And he not only appeared to them, but he made continued appearances over a 40-day period where they saw him, they talked to him, they ate with him, they drank with him, they touched him, proving that this was a bodily resurrection from the dead. So that resurrection served the purpose of proving that Jesus, his claims were true, that he is God, that he does have the power over life and death. And he actually prophesied and predicted and claimed that he would raise himself from the dead as a sign. Because the Jews, they didn't believe his claims. And they said, well, prove it to us. Give us a sign. And even though he performed many miracles as proof, he says, the sign I'll give you is the sign of Jonah. As Jonah was in the belly of the whale for 3 days and three nights, so shall the Son of Man be in the heart of the earth for 3 days and three nights. He also used another example to answer that question, demanding a sign. He said, destroy this temple, in 3 days I won't raise it up. And they said, how can you build a temple in 3 days? It took our fathers 40 years to build a temple. And the scripture says he wasn't talking about the temple in Jerusalem. He's talking about the temple of his body. So he was talking about his death, burial, and resurrection as a sign, as proof. The resurrection is the proof that his claims are true. That's what gave the apostles confidence to go out and preach the gospel. And that's what gives me, and it should give all of us, confidence today that our faith is not in vain, that our faith is justified. I believe this verse here, we all have different ways of interpreting this verse, but the way I'm going to interpret this verse, Romans 4, 24 and 25, it says, but for us also, to whom it shall be imputed, if we believe on him that raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was delivered for our offenses and was raised again for our justification. I don't believe the word justification in this case is referring to being justified before God at the judgment, saying, you're good to go, you're not guilty. I believe the justification in this case is talking about you're justified in putting your faith in Jesus. In other words, if I said, well, why should I believe in Jesus? What? Give me a good reason why you can justify me putting my faith in him. And I would say, well, putting your faith in him is justified by the resurrection. He proved it to you. So therefore, you should feel confident or justified that believing in him is the truth. Now, I know that maybe other people will interpret that verse differently, but that's how I see that verse. Okay, so I asked Daniel to answer the question, and you couldn't get your sound working yet. Are you available now, Daniel?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay. You want to answer the question and respond to what I said?
All right. So if I'm understanding right, the question is, what does the resurrection mean to us and what does it mean to the world, basically? The
significance. I'm using the word significance because I want you to approach it from that. What is the significance of the resurrection for the believer and for the world as a whole? And my claim, if you listen, was to the world as a whole, it's our greatest apologetics argument. For the believer, it's the justification of actually trusting Jesus. Why should I trust Jesus? Because he proved it through the resurrection.
Right. I like to take it one step further in that the resurrection shows God's seal of approval on that sacrifice. But see, when he was resurrected, there was still one thing left he had to do. And I caught it during my discussion with Aaron the other day between the different versions, okay? Remember, he saw Mary in John chapter 20, and when he said Mary, and she said, Rabboni, then he said to her, touch me not, for I have not yet ascended. Then he said, go tell the brethren I ascend to my Father, your Father. Well, later in that, when he sees Thomas, he says, reach thither your finger and, you know, touch my side, it's me. So between the time he saw Mary and he saw Thomas, he did what was mentioned in Hebrews chapter 9, where he went into heaven itself and put his blood on the mercy seat, not the figures made with hands, not the one in the temple, but the real mercy seat in heaven. And he put that blood there. And so that was, you know, showed the payment in full, so to speak. When he came back, basically the door of heaven is wide open to whosoever will. Well, the resurrection showed that God accepted the payment of his death as the sacrifice. But see, he still had to become the high priest and put that blood on that mercy seat. So, you know, it works in conjunction. But I noticed in the other versions, it said, don't hold on to me. And see, that there's a big difference, because the high priest in the Old Testament, when he went and put the blood on the mercy seat, he could not be touched after he was cleansed. He had to go in without being touched by man. The same reason Jesus could not be touched by Mary, otherwise it could corrupt that him being the high priest and what he was doing. So every word matters in the Word of God. So, but by his resurrection, for us, that means that he had the power over death and hell. Death could not hold him, neither could hell. He went down 3 days, preached to the spirits in prison, and he led captivity captive out, I believe. That's why I believe that, you know, he had to be the firstborn from the grave, meaning the first person who died and was risen again had to be him taking the blood in. So all the Old Testament saints, that's when he took them in. That's why I believe that they couldn't go in yet. So that's kind of getting off topic. But for the rest of the world, you know, it's just the idea. But it hinges on what their faith is. If they believe that he truly resurrected, then that means they're accountable to find out what exactly that means for them. But, you know, it's the pivotal point in a lot of people's minds that go against the Word of God. And they just claim that, well, you know, he never really rose from the dead, or, you know, he never really died, like, you know, the Muslims try to say, even though I think I showed some of them before in, can't remember what the passage is, but I think it's Surah 3, where it says, even in their scripture, Allah killed him, basically, and then would bring him back to life. So, if people can get over that and believe that he resurrected, then there's some hope for them to believe the gospel, because that is a pivotal point. Most of the world tries to say that he died and he never really, you know, resurrected from the dead. If he didn't, then like Paul said, our faith is in vain. But we know, and that is the sign to the world, that if he resurrected, then that means it proved everything he said, and that everything he said concerning the sin is also true, meaning he put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. But a lot of people just, you know, they don't want to believe that. But it's to the point that the Israelites in that day, they knew that it happened, and yet they still rejected him and paid the guards off to lie about it. So just because people know that he resurrected doesn't mean that they'll still believe the gospel.
Yes, that's very true. I watched a video yesterday from Brother Michael, Ultimate Mordecai, on the resurrection. And he was expressing that the resurrection, he was saying basically what this translation is saying here. When I'm going to read from the Amplified. And I imagine that other translations will use this word too. The KJV says, raised again for our justification. But the Amplified says, but for our sake also, to whom righteousness will be credited, as those who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was betrayed and crucified because of our sins, and was raised from the dead because of our justification, that is, our acquittal, absolving us of all sin before God. So this translation and Brother Michael, the point being made is that he was raised because we are justified or we're absolved of our sin, because our sins are cleansed, because of our acquittal. Because of it, he was raised. In other words, he couldn't have been raised unless the sin debt was actually paid, is the point that's being made in this translation and others. And that's what way that Brother Michael was teaching it yesterday. I think, though, otherwise. Okay. Any more on that before we move on? Okay, let's go to the questions that we've got from the viewers. This one is from Andrew Barnes. He wrote, Brother Luke, I have a question. As you may know, I came out of the Anglican Church in Australia. My experience was that Anglicans seem to believe some kind of Calvinism, although it is not official. Anyway, the gospel that I was raised in was that you must repent of your sins and commit your life to Christ to be saved. Now I am trying to convince my family that this is not true, but I don't have a good understanding of what the Anglican Church officially teaches. Would you have any comments or useful resources? I did look up something about the Anglican Church, their doctrines, so because I wasn't really familiar with it. So I looked it up. But before I do, Matthias, do you have an answer for that question?
No, I don't. I would have to look up what the Anglican is. I would think that it would be more like, you know, the closer to Roman Catholicism. But I mean, I can help try to give you some advice on how to preach the gospel, but particularly to those people, I'm sorry, I don't.
All right. I'm going to give a little synopsis of what it is, but first let me ask Daniel, what's your thoughts on this? All right. I guess Daniel can't get his audio working. Here's a... You can look this up for yourself. Just look up Anglican church doctrines. And what I came up with is that they're basically, they have 39 articles of faith. And then they have another one that's called 10 articles of faith. So I guess they have a top 10 and a total of 39. And the first five are essential for salvation, according to them. And so they say that the Bible and the three ecumenical creeds are the basis and summary of true Christian faith. I'm familiar with all the Christian creeds. I've got a playlist titled Christian Creeds, and I've gone through them line by line and analyzed them, and they're very good. I don't have any fault in the creeds, but they're really not talking about salvation in those creeds. They're talking about the Godhead, describing the Godhead, developing the idea of Father, Son, Holy Ghost, and yet one God. So the creeds are good. And of course, the Bible is what we believe. We go for the truth. So I don't find any fault in their first point. Their second point is baptism imparts remission of sins and regeneration and is necessary for salvation, even in the case of infants. It condemns the opinions of Anabaptists and Pelagians as heresy. Well, I don't know about Anabaptists, but Pelagians are, that is definitely a heresy.
The Anabaptists, Brother Luke, were, they called them that because they baptized people again when they actually believe.
Oh, okay. You mean, so let's say they're baptized as an infant and then they decide later on that they want to get baptized because they've come to real faith.
Right. So they called them Anabaptists. That means like baptized again.
Oh, okay. All right.
It was a thing to ridicule them, but they just adopted it as, okay, yeah, that's what we'll do. That's right. What we are rebaptizing.
Yes. Okay. All right. Well, I don't find any fault with that, but of course we all understand it.
You do have fault with that, saying that they had to be baptized for the remission of their sins.
Yeah, I'm talking about the Anabaptist idea of being baptized a second time.
Okay.
I don't find fault with that in that. I will say that I'm sure we've talked about this enough before. We're all in agreement that water baptism is not a requirement for salvation. So they're wrong thinking that you get your sins, remission for sins, because you get wet. We're totally against that. So that would be a heresy of this Anglican church. That was what is commonly called today a baptismal regeneration, that you're not saved. Getting wet is what causes the salvation or the new birth. The third point is the sacrament of penance with confession and absolution is also necessary for salvation. That's a heresy. It's false. The fourth point is that the body and blood of Christ are really present in the Eucharist. That's the Roman Catholic of transubstantiation. That's a heresy. The fifth point is justification is by faith, but good works are necessary. So it's faith plus good works. And they've got six other points in their top 10 here, but I don't think we need to go through all of those since they're only claiming the first five are essential for salvation. So there's the problem. Give me your thoughts on that, Matthias.
I'll go. I couldn't find that the mouse earlier. It's not the problem with audio. It's just finding the mute button with the mouse. But anyway, basically, yeah, the Anglican Church is pretty much identical to Roman Catholic. It only came about because the king wanted a divorce. The Pope wouldn't give him one. So he basically just split from that, made his own church, and then he got his divorce, Henry VIII, I think. So but all their essential beliefs are still the same, pretty much. But so that was my answer for that.
All right. I'll say this also, because since I did a little bit of research on it yesterday, not only are these doctrinal errors in terms of what they believe is necessary for salvation, but how it developed, you're right. But what was really happening at the time was they didn't want to be in Roman Catholicism. The only other option at that time was Calvinism. So you had Calvinism or Romanism. And what they did was they decided they didn't want to be either of them, but they wanted to blend, take elements of each of them. So it's kind of a blend. They have some Calvinistic doctrines and some Roman doctrines that they mix together. Matthias?
Right. So that's what I figured, that it was really close to Catholicism. I really don't have advice. I don't think I've been able to help persuade any of my Catholic family. It's tough. I'm hoping that my dad actually believed before he died, but I mean, I just spent Easter with my sister and my mom, and you know, I've tried, when you're talking to your family members who are engulfed in such a religion, the only thing that's going to get to them is God himself. And so I just keep praying for them. I told my mom when she had some heart issues the other day, you know, where I had to be like, look, if you died, I would doubt you're would be in heaven. Would you take time and talk to me about the difference in our beliefs? And her answer was, we don't have to believe the same thing. I'm like, I know we don't, but that's the only thing that matters. So advice, just love them, be there for them, and keep praying that God gives opportunities to where you can be salt, light, and be there for an answer. And hopefully they'll get a little bit of itching ears in the way that we want them, that they want to see the difference in what you believe. But advice, I wish I could come up with some advice to help myself. I'm going through the same thing. So you pray for me and I'll pray for you.
Okay. Thank you, brother. I think the same as far as advising someone how to witness to the people who are in this Anglican is the same advice you give to everybody, regardless of where they're coming from. And I don't think it really, we would change our methodology or that much. But last Monday, I was on Talk and Doctrine, the subject was how to witness to friends and family. So that's the first place I would send you, is to watch that. Thank you, Matthias, for helping me to mirror it. I was able to get it up on my channel also now. So you can find that. It's a two-hour discussion with Brother Cripps and myself, how to witness to friends and family. So I hope you go watch that. And everything discussed in there, I think, will apply to Anglicans or anybody else. But one of the points that I made in there is that it's not our burden and responsibility to make someone a believer. We are told to be ambassadors, to share the gospel. So it is a command that we should be obedient and faithful to share the gospel. But as far as gaining a conversion, it's out of our hands. We cannot make anybody believe. So as long as you have done made your attempts to share the gospel with them and use all the techniques and stuff that are in that video I just referred you to, just make your best effort. But you've got to realize that if you try too hard, you're not going to draw them to Christ. You're going to be pushing them away. You have to exercise some discernment and realize that, does this person have ears to hear or not? And maybe it's the wrong time in their life. They're just not interested. They think it's foolishness, you know. But if you at least let them know that, look, I've read the Bible. I know what the Bible says about this. If you ever want to know about it and consider that, then I'll be there for you. And you might find out that 5 years or 10 years later, they're contacting saying, hey, I remember you telling me that you read the Bible and I have some questions. Yeah, that does happen. It's happened many times in my case. All right, any more on that before we go to the next question?
Just a couple things real quick. Do you have your fan blowing?
Yes, I do. I'm sorry.
No, you're fine. Just get it a little.
Turn it off. Was the sound pretty bad because of that?
You could hear it when it was coming across your microphone, but as long as you turn it away from your microphone, we can't hear it. It's the wind actually coming across your microphone that we're hearing. So you can leave it on, just turn it away from the microphone.
How about now? Can you hear me okay? I moved my microphone to the other side of the computer, so I don't have fan on right now, but can you still hear me okay from this position?
It's a little lighter than your normal position, but we can hear you. Turn yourself up at the control room and it should be fine then.
Yeah. All right.
And then the other thing is I want to bring a question to the panel when we get a chance for the day of what day of the week do you think Jesus died on the cross? But we can, I just want to talk about it today since it's that day. But yeah, we can do it later.
Okay, let's do that now before we go to another question. The next question will be yours. You know, the Roman Catholic cult has coined the term Good Friday, claiming that Jesus died on Friday, and the 3 days represents he died on Friday, and then he was, and then Saturday's the second day, this Sabbath, and then Sunday's the resurrection, and that's the 3 days. I cannot give you a real detailed explanation as to why, but I remember that from all the Dr. Ruckman books I've read, he did go into great detail on this, and he disputes that it was Friday. I believe he said it was actually Wednesday. You'd think maybe if they're off, maybe they're off by one day, and it's it was Thursday. But I believe Dr. Ruckman's position is that he was actually crucified on Wednesday. But I don't know. I don't, off the top of my head, I cannot prove that in any case.
Daniel, you want to go, or you want me to go?
I can go. I believe he died on a Wednesday because he was 3 days and three nights in the grave. So Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, Thursday night, Friday night, Saturday night, and he rose on the first day of the week. So that's how I saw it. Plus the, you know, the Passover, the high Passover was on that Thursday. So they were trying to get him down from the cross before that day. So that's why they were trying to break the legs of the other two. So, but he already died. So anyhow, that's how I see it.
All right. Matthias.
So yeah, he did. I agree. He, to us, it would be Wednesday night, but it would be 6 p.m. And that actually was the evening of the next day, and the next day actually started in the evening. Remember, the Bible says the evening and the morning were the first day. We're backwards by having the morning first and then the evening second. But so to us, it would be Wednesday, 6 p.m., but really to them, it was actually Thursday. It was the very beginning of their Thursday. And so just as Daniel just said, 3 days and three nights, it's 72 hours that he stayed in the ground. If you believe in a 24-hour literal day from creation, it's 7 days, then he was in the ground for three full days, 72 hours. And one of the things that it's not in scripture, you just have to add up all the different things that are said. But I think the 3 hours of darkness were basically from 3 p.m. to 6 p.m. that Wednesday, and he died at 6. And 72 hours later, I think he arose, which means that, remember, the Sabbath ends at the even time. So I think Jesus actually arose in the evening of Saturday, right when the Sabbath ended. But nobody saw him until they went the first morning. You know, the first morning is, you know, the evening comes before the morning, remember? So he arose probably around 6 p.m. Saturday, but it wasn't until daybreak Sunday morning that they actually encountered him. So I wonder, what did he do for those hours? We don't have any record or account of it. It's not spoken of. But if you break down, and I'm so against Ruckman in so many different things, but I would love to see how he breaks this down and where he gets to the 72 hours. Because, yes, I agree. To us, it would be a Wednesday evening. I was giving my own personal prayers, recognizing that he died. I was hoping to do a broadcast that Wednesday, but I just didn't have time. But yes, Wednesday evening to us is what it would have been. But really, Thursday, the very beginning of their Thursday, so all day Thursday, all day Friday, all day Saturday. Because also, like what Daniel said, they had the feast day that was a Sabbath that they had to get him down by, and that was the Thursday. And this year, God lined it up because the Jubilee only comes every 49 years. And every time the Jubilee comes, it doesn't always line up right in between two Sabbaths. That only happens like every few centuries, like 4 or 5 centuries. But God lined it up perfectly to that time when Jesus was in the tomb, that there was a Sabbath for all those who claimed Jehovah. They weren't allowed to do any work at all for day one because of the feast Sabbath, the yearly feast. Day two, because of the Jubilee Sabbath. And day three, because it was the weekly Sabbath. So three Sabbaths lined up in a row, also showing that no work could be done while Jesus was taking care of our sins. But then right at the even time is when the Sabbath ended, and I think that's when he arose. That's from my research of Scripture, that's what I've come to.
Yeah. Well, I know that not only Ruckman, but many others, I've heard talk about when Jesus was actually put on the cross, nailed to the cross, it was the same time that the priest was sacrificing the lamb or the calf. I forgot what the priest actually did, but it was simultaneous for this Passover. I mean, there's many things that it just fits together like that, every little detail with the feasts and the festivals. All those things have great significance. Unfortunately, I'm not really qualified to talk off the top of my head about it all, even though a lot of times I read things and I'm blown away by it, but then it was 20 years ago, so I can't recall the details. But look into that. Yeah, it'll be fascinating. Okay, the next question is from Kimberly. Hi, Brother Luke. Can you explain to me James 2? All right, she's got actually verses 17 through 26. I'll read it. Even so, faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone. Yea, a man may say, thou hast faith, and I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works, and I will show thee my faith by my works. Thou believest that there is one God. Thou doest well. The devils also believe and tremble. But wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar? Seest thou how faith wrought with his works, and by works was faith made perfect? And the scripture was fulfilled which saith, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. Ye see then how that by works a man is justified, and not by faith only. Likewise also was not Rahab the harlot justified by works when she had received the messengers and had sent them out another way? For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. Well, there's every one of those verses is controversial. And we could spend hours, in fact, I have, on a lot of my other playlists, I've spent hours and hours just trying to explain this the problems with these verses. But let me ask Matthias and Daniel to go first, and before I take a turn at it. Go ahead.
Right. I'll have to listen to your explanation one more time to get a better understanding of where you're coming from. But yeah, this would be one of the verses, or one of the few things that Luke and I disagree about. I think that faith without works being dead, if you look at, let's see, what verse did she start with? 17? Start with 17. Oh, you're muted. I'm sorry. You're still muted.
17 through 26 is what she gave.
17 through 26. So 17 is the final thought of verse 16. And so that needs to be recognized here, because what this is talking about is, if there's no action behind your faith, people cannot see your heart like God can. The only way that they can see if you truly have faith is by your works. And don't get that misconstrued for yourself or God. This is talking about other men, other people. If you're trying to look to your works to see if you're saved, you're not, because that's just backloading works. But if somebody's trying to determine if you're saved and they look to your works, that's legit. And I think James is here saying that, because if somebody needs clothes, what doth it profit, brethren, if a man say he hath faith and not works, can faith save him? A lot of people use that part as like, oh, rhetorical. No. If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one say unto them, depart in peace, be ye warmed and filled. So you don't help them. You just say, hey, I'm gonna just feed you and clothe you with my faith. Depart in peace, you know, and just tell them to be warm and filled. Notwithstanding, ye give them not those things which are needful to the body, what doth it profit? Even so, if faith hath not works, it is dead being alone. So who is this dead to? It's to the person, the brother or sister, who's destitute of daily food, naked in daily food. So if you don't give them the works of giving them what's needful to the body, your faith is dead to them, being alone without the works. They can't see your heart as God can. So who is the faith dead to? Who's the object of that? You got to remember, it's not the person, the believer in question. It's not dead to God. It's dead to others. An example I can use is all of us here on the panel, we could have gone out and had a game of poker if we lived in the same vicinity. And we could just be, you know, we're saved by grace through faith, and we could just have fun and just hang out with each other and not do anything. Our faith would be dead to all the viewers who ever watched this, because we wouldn't have done the broadcast. But because our faith is living and there's works that we're doing, our faith is alive to those who can watch the broadcast. They can see and listen and use what they hear to, you know, go to God and ask him if his word, what it means and different things. So our faith can be living right now or dead right now, but our faith would still remain the same, because that's in Christ. So let's see. Faith without works is dead. So being justified by works, you got to go to Romans 4, where it says that Abraham was justified by his works, but not before God. He was justified by his works before men. But he went up to that altar all by himself. And Isaac, of course. But, you know, it was recorded. So his works were justified. His faith, his works justified his faith to every reader who's ever read the Bible. So, a lot of people, I don't want to go through all of these different verses. I'm sure others will go through a couple. But like Luke said, all of these verses are a little controversial in their own individual self, because people pick them out of context and try to use them for works all the time. But it really boils down to, you know, if you feel confident in somebody else's salvation, it's okay to rebuke them. Rebuke a wise man and he'll love you for it. If you feel confident in somebody's salvation and they aren't acting right, it's okay to give them godly discipline. If they're a drunkard, an extortioner, a railer, don't even eat with them. It's okay to do that. And if you feel confident in somebody's salvation, it's okay to tell them, hey, there's no way people would believe that you have true faith without showing them the works. It's okay to prop them up and put a fire under their butt. Now, because people can say things all day long. People can say they believe, and you can trust them for what they believe. If they've got the right confession, you should. But if somebody has the right confession and I see no understanding, I see no works, I see no desire for the lost to be saved, even though they have the right confession, I'll still stand in doubt of their salvation possibly, because I can't see their heart. Now, they could be saved, and hopefully they really are. But I would stand in doubt enough to keep preaching milk to them until I saw understanding, until I saw a desire for lost people to get saved. So I think that James here is actually just putting a fire under believers' butts, saying, get up and act like the way you say you believe. Now, again, we don't want to misconstrue works in any way, shape, or form. That's why I think James 2 is definitely written to believers, and it's trying to say, you know, get off your hands and get to work, which is a great thing, but it has nothing to do with our salvation.
Okay, thank you. Daniel, what do you say?
I think the key verse in there is where it says a man may say, I have faith, but he says, I will show you my faith by my works. Because the Bible says that man looketh upon the outward appearance, but God looketh upon the heart. So that's the difference between, you know, us showing our faith, because people can't see our belief. They can only see our works. So that's the whole context of James, showing our works before men, because when you start at the chapter 2, it's talking about, you know, if you see a man that's hungry, you know, you need food or clothes, you know, can faith save him? I mean, he says, be filled, but don't give him anything. You're not helping him. So that's where he's talking about the, you know, before men. And of course, he mentioned Romans 4. Before God, Abraham learned he couldn't glory in anything before God except Christ.
Okay. First of all, I don't have an issue with Matthias's answer or Daniel's answer. I'll also say Renee has made a lot of videos on this, and she has a similar answer, going into great detail, justifying that position. Brother Jason, not Cripps. Jason Jack. Why can't I remember Brother Jason and Jack's last name half the time? Brother Jason Jack, he has also made some excellent videos on this subject. I suggest you watch Renee's and Jason's and listen to Daniel and Matthias. Their viewpoint pretty much is the common accepted viewpoint. And I don't, I would not, how should I say? I think it's not what's happening. I don't, that's not how I see it. But I don't object to them saying it. I have no, I find no fault in it, because what they're not doing is teaching James from a lordship position to support lordship heresy. If someone uses, and we all know that the book for the lordship heretic is James. Now, you can find things all throughout the Bible to try to make it support faith alone is not enough, you know. You, but James is the book for the lordship heretic and for Mormonism and for any works-based, all the works-based religions. James is their book. Why is that? It's because there are many verses in James, all the verses we just read, they can use those verses and basically just read it to you, and most people don't have an answer, because it seems to be saying, and I'm saying, it clearly says one thing. Now, all of us, and now I gave the same answers as everybody else for 25 years. And I was convinced that's the correct way of understanding it and teaching it. That the way I would sum it up is that from that viewpoint is that Paul, and I'm contrasting Paul and James here right now, but Paul is speaking from the viewpoint of an evangelist. James is speaking from the viewpoint of a pastor. Okay, assuming that you're already saved, now that you're saved, let's get busy doing some works. Otherwise, people are not going to even think you're really a Christian. From that perspective, I can understand pastors urging people to get busy working. And we all do that. Say, you got a ministry now, let's get busy working and for the kingdom, but not for our salvation. But so that is an acceptable way for me to have someone teach it. They're not teaching, using it to support lordship heresy. However, I just don't think about 5 or 6 years ago, I had one of my closest friends on YouTube. His name is Mitch Balenkov. He worked closely with me for probably a year. Well, he had a different take on the book of James, and he wasn't talking about it publicly, but privately, he and I would talk about it. We probably discussed it for a year and before anything was said publicly. And I was arguing the same viewpoint that you just heard here. That's my position. And I heard this position from Mitch. And at first I was really shocked. It sounded even heretical. And I thought, how could you say such a thing? But eventually arguing in a respectful way, the way that we do, having a dialogue, disagreeing, but trying to work it out together, eventually, I switched sides. He won me over to that side. What is that other viewpoint? I have a playlist titled James and Paul, The Shocking Facts. I don't know how many hours are on it, but let's say there's 5 or 10 hours of teaching on this. I also have a playlist, verse by verse teaching on the book of Acts, and a verse-by-verse teaching on the book of Galatians. Those three studies together all fit together to explain this position. I'm going to try to summarize it in like this. It's not really fair to me or my viewpoint for me to try to explain it this way, but for time's sake, I have to do it. I hope you'll go and watch the playlist, at least the one, James and Paul, The Shocking Facts. The position I take in there is that instead of taking James's words and trying to explain it in a different way than comes off initially, because everybody who reads James the very first time is, what? How? That sounds like he's contradicting Paul. And well, we can try to explain it. It's kind of like we have to twist it around to make it fit so there's not a contradiction. But I believe he is contradicting Paul. I think James and Paul disagreed. I think in the very beginning of church history, we've said this over and over again, there are clearly two things in the beginning of the church that had to change over the book of Acts gives us a historical record of all these events here. That's why the book of Acts is called a transitional book. The church went through a transitional period. What transitional means, it changed from one thing to another. Almost every commentary on the book of Acts calls it a transitional book. Well, you got to ask yourself, transitioning from what to what? Well, initially the church was only Jews. They had no idea the Gentiles would be included until Peter was sent to Cornelius. And then they finally accepted that Jews, Gentiles would be part of it, but I believe grudgingly. They didn't want it. There was great prejudice against Gentiles. For all the book of Acts, they still didn't want Gentiles in all the way through the end of that book. I don't believe they ever really were happy about having Gentiles included. The other thing that had to change from the beginning was that since it was only Jews, there was no reason for them to stop practicing Judaism. There was no reason for them to think that all the practices and tenets of Judaism did not still apply. So they thought that getting circumcision was still needed, following all the laws of Moses, keeping the Sabbath, even going to the temple and doing the sacrifices. That's what in Hebrews is talking about that situation. So that those things had to change, and gradually they did, primarily because Paul championed these things. Paul is the one that had the burden of saying, we need to leave Judaism out of this now. That's time is over. No more Judaism. And we need, and that means it's by grace alone, through faith alone, Christ alone. So my position is that rather than trying to explain away these glaring problems in James, saying it doesn't really mean what he says, now I would have to think then that James is not very good at communicating. Not at all. Because it seems like he's clearly saying one thing. Why can't he, if he's saying something different than what everybody thinks the first time they read it, then he didn't do a very good job of expressing himself. No, I think he wrote it exactly what he believed initially in the beginning of church, that man is justified by works and not by faith only. That's contradictory of what we all teach. We're justified by faith only. James says, no, you're justified by works and not by faith only. Did he misspeak? Did he not know how to communicate it, what he was really intending for us to understand? Or is that what he really believed at the beginning of the time of the church?
Well, can I ask you something on that, Brother Luke?
Yes, you can.
Do you believe that James was saved when he wrote that?
No. I believe that he probably got saved later on. I believe James was the first book penned. If you look at when all the books of the Bible of the New Testament were penned, most people think that James was the earliest book. So James writing from that perspective before these things were all worked out. And then this, the first video on my playlist, Shocking James and Paul, The Shocking Facts, the first one is I actually do a little skit. It's only like a 10-minute video. So if you don't do anything else, just watch the first video on that list. I think the 10-minute video, I wear a hat and I say, when I'm wearing the hat and I'm speaking, I'm Paul. When I take the hat off, I'm speaking, I'm James. And all I do is take the words of Paul and the words of James and have this conversation, an argument, I call it, an argument between James and Paul. And that this is what's actually going on. There was an argument in the church between these two parties. So did James believe later on? I assume he did, and I hope he did, but I don't know for sure. Now, then the logical question is, well, is James scripture, and does it belong in the Bible? I believe it does belong in the Bible. There's a lot of things in the Bible that are false teachings that we want in the Bible because it tells us what was actually going on at the time. you go out Acts chapter 15, verse 1, they say, you can't get saved unless you're circumcised. That's in the Bible. And yet we know that, that was a false teaching, and Paul had to go to the Jerusalem council to address that false teaching. So all I would ask is that if I'm correct, then James is just expressing one of the problems in the beginning of the church. The other problem, as I said, was that, Gentiles were not allowed. And here's something that could help people understand it too. When I first read the Bible for many, many years, I thought when Pentecost happened, the church began. I still believe church began at Pentecost. But I thought when Stephen was martyred, I thought that was only a matter of weeks after Pentecost. That was my first impression. And I believed that for a long time, that it was only a few weeks or maybe a few months past and Stephen was martyred. But if you look at the timelines of most of the people who've studied how the timeline of all these events, that was 3.5 years after Pentecost. And then when did Paul go on the road to Damascus and get saved? That was 6 years after Pentecost, before Paul even got saved. And during that time, it was only Jews. And then 10 years after Pentecost was when Peter was sent to Cornelius. That 10 years is only Jews, and there's no indication from to anybody that they need to stop circumcising and stop putting their faith in all following all the laws. It was you're a Jew. If you're not a Jew, you got to become a Jew, and then you can be saved. And so even when the Gentiles came in 10 years later, they were insisting that they basically become Jews. You got to get circumcised and do this and this, and there was a dispute over that. So now after that, Cornelius, 10 years later, and then 1 year after that is when James confronted Peter over preaching to Cornelius and them, and they had that initial argument, and James says, I don't care what man says. God told me to go tell the Gentiles this, and I'm going to do what God said rather than the man. That was the first argument about this. But guess what? That was 11 years after Pentecost. 20 years after Pentecost is the Jerusalem Council. That's 9 years after the first argument with James and Jerusalem Church. 9 years later, they still hadn't resolved this, and they're going to Paul's territory and teaching, you got to be circumcised. Paul's a false teacher. And Paul says, we're going to go settle this. We're going to Jerusalem. And they had that council, and they settled it. But I don't think James, even at that time, I don't get the impression that James in the Jerusalem church even was happy with it then. And when he says, okay, Paul, you go talk to the Gentiles and we'll focus on the Jews. I don't think that they were sending him off to be with the Gentiles because they were real happy. Okay, we got our jobs assigned now. The Jews are for us and the Gentiles are for Paul, and we'll all work, cooperate. No, I think an Aaron Budgen, who was studying to be a Jewish rabbi and then became a believer, go to his channel and watch his video on this subject. Faith and Works is the title of it. He's telling exactly what I'm saying, that when they sent Paul off, it wasn't because of, oh, we love Paul and we're so happy he's with us. Oh, this is our opportunity to get rid of Paul, get him out of here. In fact, people wanted to kill him. Remember 10 years before that? Because Paul is saying you don't have to follow law anymore. So they took an oath. They're going to kill Paul. They're not going to eat until he's dead. So all these things are part of a timeline of events where these two problems had to be worked out and resolved. It's not just for Jews only, and Judaism is not part of it. We can't mix them together. That's how I see it. Now, I've got, as I said, these playlists I send you to. You've got 20 hours to give you every little detail on why I make this conclusion. All right.
I got a quick question for you, Brother Luke. What if somebody was trying to tell you that the lost people, the Bible's not for lost people. The lost people are only supposed to listen to the preaching of the saved because the Bible's only for saved people. because God doesn't even listen to the prayers of the lost. And I gave him the example of Cornelius, and the response was, well, Cornelius was a Jew. Is there any way, shape, or form you would think that the Bible shows that Cornelius could have possibly been a Jew? You're still muted.
Well, could he have been a Jew already? I don't know if I could prove absolutely he was not a Jew. It is very broadly accepted that he was not a Jew, that he was the first Gentile in the church. So as far as changing that consensus opinion, how we go about, you know, supporting that, no, he was already really a Jew, I don't know how we would support that. But I can't say absolutely. Maybe he was a Jew at the time, but if he was a Gentile who converted to Judaism and then converted to Jesus. But I don't think he was a Jew.
Right. Because, well, for one, I don't think everyone would have gotten mad at him for going there and eating with them had he been a Jew.
Oh, exactly. That should settle it right there, because you see, the people they really don't understand the degree of prejudice and segregation that existed in that place and time. The Jews, the only thing worse than a Gentile was a Samaritan, because the Samaritan results of Jews and Gentiles mixing. So, man, the Jews, they really wanted to just, and God told them to not mix, because he didn't want other cultures and religions coming in and adulterating their religion. So they weren't supposed to mix, but they took this to such an extreme that you weren't even supposed to be associating with Gentiles. You couldn't go in their house. You certainly couldn't share a meal with them. And definitely you can't eat the Gentile food. All right. I don't know. Here's the important thing. Look, I never bring up this subject. I'm not on a campaign to try to make everybody understand and believe this conclusion I come to. I'd love to have you agree. I think we all like for people to agree with us and say, hey, you're right. But I don't spend any time on a crusade to do that. I accept it. As long as someone is teaching James is not a means of justifying faith is not enough, the way the Lordship here does, I'm okay with the teaching that James is urging people to do good works so people won't think you're some kind of a hypocrite and not really a Christian, or if that's what a Christian is, I don't want to be one, because they'll just say, I'll pray for you, but I'm not going to give you any food or anything. You know, all that's all valid teaching. I don't object to it, but I don't think that's really what happened. I don't think that's the context of all these things.
Brother Luke, I will go and listen to that, and I'd like to, you know, I'll listen to your playlist on it. If I can come up with something to change your mind, would you consider it?
Yeah, of course I'll consider it.
Okay.
And after all, I made a video titled Quick to Listen, Slow to Speak, 8 Times I Changed My Mind. I made that about a month ago. And I mentioned the book of James. I mentioned other times. 8 times I've changed my mind, and because I'm always willing to listen, because there's always a chance I could be wrong about something, and that's why I changed my mind 8 times, because I was willing to listen. But I'm not going to there's a quote I like. I'm not going to be a stubborn fool holding on to an error once I've been proven wrong. If anybody can show me I'm wrong on this, but it took about a year to get me from your side. I was in complete agreement with you. It took me about a year for someone to persuade me. First, they gave me a lot of the things I've been telling you, but I had to go through the scriptures as a Berean, looking and checking it all out. And before I was any of these changes I've made, brother, it's normally it takes me, like the flat earth question, it took me a year before I could accept it. And it's the same thing with the book. You think I was just going to real eager to jump on board and say, Yeah, I'm going to be a contrarian. Everything that we teach about the Book of James, I'm going to disagree with everybody. I'm not eager to disagree and take some minority viewpoint.
Right. It is an interesting viewpoint because I think you're the only one that I've heard that believes that a lost man penned a book of the Bible. So that is definitely an interesting point of view for sure.
Yeah.
But I will go listen to your playlist about it, you know, and give it its due process.
Let's not, I've had people accuse me, especially early on when I first started talking about this, accuse me of saying that James should not be in the canon. I've never said that or taught that. I believe there's a lot of things that are in the Bible that people we'd love to have not there, because like look at some things in 1 John and in 2 Peter and stuff, things that are really difficult and you will wonder how, and there was a lot of arguments over all these. There's like, I'd say there's probably 10 books, 8 or 10 books in the Bible, there was great dispute of whether it should be in or not, and that before they did get in. And so why did they resist them being in? Because there's difficult things to resolve in those books. But I don't say those books shouldn't be there. I'm just saying that sometimes these books, I don't have a lot of confidence that I understand them that well, because they seem to be contradicting things that are clear. If something's really clear, I'm going to embrace it and I'm going to, you know, fight for it because it's clear cut. But when something's either seems to contradict it or is ambiguous, I can't speak with great confidence about it. So with the Book of James, I'm saying, yeah, it should be there. And I'm happy that it's there because it tells me that it supports my conclusion that from reading the Book of Acts, of all of the arguing that was going on, and then all the things that happened in the Book of Galatians, and even in the Book of Romans, and the Book of Hebrews, all of these conflicts going on over doctrine, and what does it boil down to? Everything boils down to holding on to some aspect of Judaism, instead of letting it all go.
I have one question. Do you think that there's any other books that were written by lost people?
No, I don't. I'm not saying that there aren't, because I can't say absolutely without, because there, as I said, there's a couple of other books that make me not have a lot of confidence in how, if I understand it exactly right. So that I have to leave it at that. I really don't know how to take some of the, like I've often talked about some of the parables. I'm not going to teach on that because I can't.
Wait, brother, you just turned your fan on. It's going, or you just moved it. It's going right over the mic.
I'm sorry. Yeah, if I turn the fan on, it becomes that obvious. It's a problem. So I'll just turn it off.
Sounds like you're beating a drum.
Okay. I can live without the fan until I stop talking, and then I'll turn it on. But
right, but it's also, Brother Luke, we don't hear the fan. If you will adjust it to where the wind is not blowing over the microphone, that's what we're hearing.
Yeah, but then the fan won't be hitting me, my body, and cooling me off.
Gotcha.
Yeah, it won't do me any good if it's not blowing on me. Okay, so back to your question about other books. No, I'm not asking for any of the books or saying any of the books should be left out. I'm just saying there are some books that are real clear to me and some books that I don't have a lot of confidence that I understand it correctly. And when I show you why the conclusions on James, you can see, well, maybe there's some problems in some of the other books too, because I don't know how to necessarily take it all. Well, we do the best we can, and a lot of times I just have to rely on you or Renee or somebody else to explain things to me in these other books, because I don't have confidence I've got that right. All right, any more before we go to another question?
No, I myself think that Nebuchadnezzar was a lost man. He was saved when he penned it, but what he was writing about was the time when he was lost. So I've thought about it myself. Is there somebody? And I would say Nebuchadnezzar would be the closest for me, but
I'm not aware of Nebuchadnezzar being acknowledged as one of the writers.
Chapter 4, Daniel.
Daniel chapter 4 was written by Nebuchadnezzar?
Mm-hmm.
I have no idea about that. Huh. Okay, I'll have to go back and look at that so I can see what you mean. Interesting. Okay, next question. This one is from Katarina. Oh, wait a second. We've only got 15 minutes left. I better find a question that's really short. All right, this one ought to be short. This is from Katarina Marineau. Hello, Brother Luke. My name is Catherine. I have a question. Is it so that God might break us in order to position us or to remold us? Thank you and God bless. So does God sometimes want to break us in order to remold us? Whoever wants to take that, go ahead.
Daniel, if you want to go first, you can.
Is it, you know, does God break us or mold us? Is that kind of the question? You're muted, brother.
Let me read it again. It's a very simple, short question here. It says, is it so that God might break us in order to position us or to remold us?
Okay, yeah. I believe so, because he uses the analogy of the potter and the clay, you know, the potter and the clay wheel. And when you see how pottery is made, sometimes that does happen and they start over, you know, to try to get it to be the perfect piece. So in a sense, you know, I would agree, but it all comes back to what you believe breaking is, you know. You know, it's like breaking a horse that's being trained, you know, so it could be the definitions of what you mean too that make the difference.
Well, let me go next. My answer is very short, but I've often said this over the years that there's how do people receive this gospel? How do they respond to it? All kinds of different responses. But many times people will not receive this good news with joy and get saved because they're not ready to receive it in their life. Let's say that they don't even want to think about an afterlife. They're only thinking about here and now, because let's say they're rich, they're healthy, everything's going great in their life, they're just having a great time. What? Last thing I want to talk about and think about is when I die, what happens? Go, just change the subject. And they're just, the time in their life is not right. And sometimes later on in life, because of going through ordeals, then they see the need. That's what happened to me. I didn't see the need for looking at the Bible or thinking about, Jesus until my mother died. When she died, it's the first death in my family. And I was confronted with this for the first time. I need an answer now. What happens after we die? Is there really a purpose to life? Which religion is true? Is the Bible true? What about Jesus? All these questions came to my mind, and it was because my mother died, and I knew it made me even more aware that, wait, and, you know, I can try to brush the thoughts aside now. I was 36 years old. I know it's still in the distant future before I'm going to probably die, but it forced the issue with me. Hey, I am mortal. Maybe I better get some answers. And so the idea was, I will say, people do not get on their knees and seek God until they get knocked down on their knees by something in their life. Now, is God knocking them down? I think sometimes maybe God will knock us down to make us get on our knees and put us in that state that we're, it's not as a form of punishment. See, that's where I've changed my mind about chastisement, exactly what that is. I don't think it's God giving us spankings, any kind of, because there's no punishment for sins, and he just paid for all the sins on the cross. But as far as chastising is, I think it's more like the shepherd using his staff to steer the sheep in a certain direction, but rather than something that's corporal and painful. But apart from that, making a person ready to listen to the gospel, I think God probably does sometimes cause people to reach a point in their life that they can be realize that, hey, you are mortal, or you're in some kind of pain or something. Maybe you better call out to God and say, God, I need some answers. God, help me. I need you. I recognize a need for God. I need to know who God is. Matthias?
I would say that God could knock down or break a child of his that is getting prideful, especially prideful in preaching of the word. Maybe not necessarily in chastisement. Now, I do think that chastisement does come, but I don't think he'll break us in that sense. I do think that he will, just like Luke was saying, he will break those who are lost. I say sometimes he'll knock their kneecaps out or put them on their back so all they can do is look up. And that's actually a huge blessing because not everyone gets that. God does do that to many, though. To position us, you know, sometimes things that seem like are might break us is actually God just showing us how strong we are in him. And so while they might be detrimental at the time, the places it brings you are places that you're able to glorify and praise God for. So maybe sometimes breaking to reposition needs to be looked at a little differently. Sometimes he'll mold and put us in different places, and sometimes the means of which we get there, we don't necessarily see the lights or the good thereof, but all things work for the good of those who believe. And if you know you're one who believes, then you know that good is being worked out from it. So I don't think God will break his saints, but he will break the lost. I don't think he will... I think God will use circumstances from our perspective, good or bad, to reposition us. So again, the definition of break needs to be really established. But no, I don't think God ever breaks us other than a sin unto death, if that's a broken body. But the him trying to put us down for even our sin, I don't see that even repositioning us. I just don't see it anywhere in scripture for that.
Hey, one other thing I wanted to add on that is, you know, the kind of vessels that God tends to use, you could say, are broken vessels. Now, whether that's him breaking you through circumstances in life or not, you know, you could maybe debate that. But, you know, you think about Gideon, what they had to do with the lamps, you know, and a lesson in that is those lamps had to be broken so the light could shine forward. So, you know, like I said, it depends on how you define what breaking is and all for what purpose it is. But it's definitely an interesting and a good question.
Well, there probably are a lot of examples, if we really took our time to think about it, of people where they were broken. Now, as you said, is God doing the breaking, or is it just the circumstances of life that's causing them to be broken and recognize, hey, I'm helpless and hopeless. If there's a higher power, a God of some kind, I recognize a need for it. Now I need to learn about this. So I don't know. The question really is God doing it. And in that case, I would suspect that he probably does do it to a certain extent, but I don't consider that as form of punishment. It's maybe some form of coercion a little bit to trying to steer us. Okay, any more on that? Otherwise, I guess we've done all the questions we have time for. Anything else?
I thought of that verse where it talks about a broken and contrite spirit. So there could be some aspects of us that might need to be broken, but he's not breaking us, you know, just getting us. You know what I'm saying?
Okay, then. All right, then. How about let's sum things up now. Matthias, I haven't heard you give the gospel message for a while. Would you like to be the one to give the gospel message today?
I'm game for whatever you need.
Okay. All right, then. So, Daniel, you'll do another song, and I'll think of some exhortation, and so we'll finish up that way. I guess that means Matthias, you go first with the gospel message.
All right. I just want to say, we all miss Renee. So keep her in prayer. She's with her family. And also she's traveling, I think, down to Florida, more south than Daniel and I. But travel safety for her and her family in prayers. Her and Jim. And then the chat room, thank you for joining, and all those who watch on replay. You know, it's always a pleasure to fellowship with everybody. We enjoy the questions. Please keep them coming. The time that I have on Sunday with you guys is a blessing and edifying to me. So I thank you, and I hope it's the same for you all. And so let's see, let's talk about the gospel real quick. So this is for somebody who doesn't know if they're going to heaven or not. The only person who can know 100% if you are going to heaven, well, that's you. You and God. And you can't settle for anything less than knowing 100%. If you've gotten to the point to where you wonder, question is have you been fully persuaded? But what's it being fully persuaded of? Well, everybody's heard of Jesus. I don't think that there's very few or very many proverbial tribesmen out there who haven't gotten a wind of this man named Jesus, that he lived, and that a lot of people follow him. But who is he to you? And Jesus asked, whom do ye say that I am? The answer, the Christ, the Messiah. But where does that answer come from? Well, it comes from Scripture. Comes from when God himself clothed Adam and Eve with the skins of an animal. He preached to them that one day he would come down and he would cover their sins. He would take on the wages of their sins, the death, the sacrifice of that animal, the blood that was shed, was a picture of what God knew from the foundation of the world, what he was going to do. And so when he got on the cross, do you believe that he was imputed with your sins? Do you believe that he took your sins upon him and took that punishment? Do you believe that he is God? Oh, a lot of people can't answer that question, and no. They can regurgitate what they've heard. But do you have the full assurance that God himself took on your sins, not just the world's, but yours personally. You know that. And if you know that, one thing that you will absolutely be assured of is where you're going when you die. Do you fear that you might not be with him? Do you fear that the Bible may not be true? Do you fear that you got to keep your own salvation? See, these are questions that a lot of people struggle with. But the answer to a saint is no. I know who I've believed and whom I've been persuaded that what I've trusted with him, with Jesus, is sufficient, and that what Jesus did on the cross satisfied a holy God. Everybody's heard of the death, burial, resurrection, and believing it is the most important thing you can do. But can you do it on your own? That's what separates the truth from fiction right there. Can you believe anything outside of evidence persuading you? And are you humble enough to go to God's word and reason with him and ask him to make sense of what it is he's trying to tell you? Most people just try to make themselves believe, and really that's nothing but make belief. But if you honestly want to know him, and you don't, by talking to him, just the way I'm talking to you right now, the way you talk to your friends, your family, your children, your parents, just talk to him. Get in his word. Ask him to reveal himself to you. Take the time. Is it important enough for you to put on the yoke and learn? To learn who he is and what he's done. You just can't wave a wand and make yourself believe. And remember that God wants you to be saved more than you want to be saved. So again, if you don't know him, my suggestion would be get to know him. Don't try to get saved. Get to know him. People who try to go to the Word of God, try to go to him in prayers, and their only objective is to get saved, it seems to take them, well, forever. But those who just recognize that they want to know truth and want to have a relationship with their Creator and his reasoning to see if his word is from him, you just want to know the truth and get to know him. The people who go searching, seeking for him in that manner, they seem to come to find him usually within a shorter weeks, months, a year. But I know people for years and years been trying to get saved. So the death, burial, resurrection, it's important. But all false converts say they believe that. Do you have the assurance that God only gives his children? And if you don't, how do you get it? Well, I just answered it. It's an assurance that only God himself can give. So just go to him, be patient, wait on him, talk to him, ask him to reveal himself to you, and don't settle for anything less than knowing 100%. And when you do, that joy, that dancing, that happy dance that Luke is famous for, it kind of boils over, whether in flesh or in spirit. But understanding what he's done and where you stand in him gets you standing for joy. I pray somebody can use that and come to the Lord. God bless you all.
Amen. Thank you, brother. All right. We're talking about earlier about different parts of the Bible where I admit I'm not so confident I really understand it, but there's a portion of scripture in First John that I use to point out that I believe that when a message is given to a church, the message is under the understanding that you have a mixed audience. So sometimes, even though the message is to a part of it's to the church who already believe, recognizing that there's also some people in the audience that maybe they're not believers yet, we got to make sure we also include that for them. Well, that's that message Matthias gave is not for us who believe. We already have this joy and peace and blessed assurance, and because that's what the gospel is. It's the assurance that I'm going to heaven. Nothing can change that. Thank you, Jesus. But the people who don't have that, I hope you listen carefully to Matthias. Now, how about those people who already have believed in Jesus? They have the gift and the guarantee of eternal life. And there are things we're supposed to be busy doing as believers. God has a purpose for us. It's not just to get saved and promise eternal life and then you forget about it. No, God's got us now in his employ, and we should be busy working for the Lord, not to get our salvation or to maintain it or to even prove it to others, but because it is an honor and a privilege to be able to represent this great God Almighty and serve him. And it's a privilege. And plus, if we get busy working for him, he does compensate. And, you know, there is a reward system for believers. Jesus built up treasures for heaven. And I'm just saying, let's get busy working for him. But one of the things I want to ask the believers to do is, we were talking about the book of James. There's a lot of controversial, difficult verses there, but there's also some verses in there that I treasure so much. And one of them is from James, is be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to wrath, or slow to anger. So I think this is something that will benefit all of us if we can develop this. Be a good listener. Don't be so quick to always feel like I'm the one that has to do the talking. You know, we learn a lot more by listening than we do by talking. Matter of fact, I don't think you learn anything by talking. Proverbs has a lot of great sayings in it. He says that if you keep quiet, you basically can keep secret from others that you're actually a fool, as long as you just keep quiet. So there's a lot of good reasons just to shut up and listen to others for a while. And so that's why I've been asking everybody to do. Let's take some time to listen to each other and consider other people's viewpoints. And you might find that you can learn something from the brethren and the sistren. I don't know if sistren is a word or not, but the brothers and sisters in Christ, we can all learn something from each other. So take some time to actually listen to the other believers. All right. That's an exhortation for the church. Now we got Brother Daniel. So we'll finish off with another song from Daniel.
All right. I was just thinking about some of the things that people are going through, and this song came to mind. So I'll give it a shot. I actually normally never sing this, so it's kind of the first go around, but it's one we used to sing, me and my sister-in-laws and my wife, when we were singing as a group. So hopefully it'll be a blessing to you. I couldn't turn this off. It's not turning off. So hopefully that you can hear me fine. When you're tired of trying, tired of crying, when you're burdened and tempted to fall, he's your refuge, strong tower, no matter the
hour, Jesus is there through it all. He is there when your load is too heavy to bear. He is there through it all. And he knows when you need him before you even go home. Jesus is there through it all. When blessings abound or when burdens surround you, when you have no defenses at all, he will hold you so you can see the battle with the enemy. It's faithful, he is there through it all. He is there when your load is too heavy to bear. He is there through it all. And he knows when you need him before you even call. Jesus is there through it all. With downcast eyes you may find in these times one set of footprints in the hot desert sand, but lift your head high and you'll find in these times you are cradled in the palm of his hand. He's your refuge, strong tower, no matter the hour. Jesus is there through it all. Jesus is there through it all.
Thank you.
Awesome. Jesus. Thank you for Brother Daniel. He's such a blessing to all of us. Okay. All right, I guess it's time to say goodnight. Until next time, to the chat room, thank you for being there. And to all the viewing audience, thank you. If it's your first time, I hope today was a blessing. Join us every Sunday, 5 p.m. Eastern. Join us Wednesdays, 9:30 p.m. Eastern for the Wednesday night Bible study. Bless you all in the name of our great Savior God, Jesus.